So let's begin with the discussion. Let me tell you what I am going to do. One of the main purpose is to, I was told, is to, I should share with you the state and minorities. A book by Dr. Ambedkar, State and Minorities, What Are Their Rights and How to Secure Them in the Constitution of Free India, that he submitted to the Constitutional Assembly on behalf of the Scheduled Caste Federation on March 15, 1947. This was submitted to the Fundamental Rights Committee, of which he was a member. The origin of this book, this memorandum, we do not know exactly what was the origin. The origin of this book is, of course, written in the introduction by Dr. Ambedkar, that since the new constitution was in the process of framing, the Scheduled Caste Federation's leaders and the body asked Dr. Ambedkar to present the viewpoint of the Scheduled Caste Federation as to what should be the constitutions, what should be the nature of the constitution, and how the rights of the minorities and the Dalits and the others should be incorporated in the constitutions. So he wrote that. But the actual story, there is also a background to it, which we were told, I think Babu Matthew and Jaffet may be knowing, those who work on the constitution history, is that he was a member of the Fundamental Right Committee in the being a member of the Constituent Assembly. There was a suggestion by Patel and others that we should have some idea as to what should be the economic aspect, provision about the economic rights in the constitutions. And everybody was asked to, members were asked to submit the note. And everybody had submitted a note, I am told. If somebody goes to the record, we might get them. And it is in response to that Dr. Ambedkar then went back to the Scheduled Caste Federation and decided to prepare a comprehensive note on behalf of Scheduled Caste Federation, which was prepared, submitted, and I think circulated internally in the Fundamental Rights Committee, discussed, and obviously rejected, not accepted fully. Part of it maybe have come in direct to principle. So that's the origin of it. But State and Minority is a very, very important book. I call it a book, it is a memorandum, because this is almost a last word on what Ambedkar's, on the solution of Dr. Ambedkar to the problem of poor in general, marginalized in general, and also Dalit and OBC and tribals in particular. This is not a book for Dalit. This is a book for Dalit, yes. But this is also a book for all poor and marginalized group, because this book gives you what kind of economic system India should have, what kind of political means and system should we have, what kind of social protection we should have against the discrimination of former untouchables. It covers everything. It was a solution to the problem of India. And second important thing is that this was his last word. In 47, after that, if you want to read his writing, there is nothing much addition by Dr. Ambedkar except Buddha, convergent to Buddhism. And the justification as to why we require Buddhism as a principle, as an ideology, is given separately. But as far as the his statement on his views on economy, society, and polity, and the program, what economic system, what social system, and what political means and system we should use, this is the last statement. And so if anybody wants to see that what are Dr. Ambedkar's views on the problem confronting India and that of discriminated group, this is the last word. Analysis for this you can see in the background. Annihilation of caste, there is analysis. Annihilation of caste is the issue of how to annihilate the caste, which he has discussed academically in that book, and there is a solution there. And that solution leads to his conversion. But that's only a part of it. Then there are other writings of his which comes as a background. But as far as the program and the strategy and ideology, if you'd like to call it, is concerned, State and Minority is most important. And I feel little bad about it because state and minority has not got as much attention as annihilation of caste has got, or at times, sometimes Buddha and his Dhamma has got. The reason is that the reason goes to the Maharashtrians, of course, because it is there the beginning had been made. And the socialist idea of Ambedkar, democratic socialist idea and economic ideas of Ambedkar were not discussed in the beginning. Dalits were very averse to it. It was Rao Sahib Kasbe who wrote the first book, Democratic Socialism and Dr. Ambedkar. We never talk that Ambedkar, in addition to caste, also talk about the economic exploitation and provide an alternative in the form of socialist economy. And what are his differences with Marxist, what are his differences with the Indian socialist. This was not the area which was discussed even in Maharashtra. Very late it is Rao Sahib Kasbe who brought it, published Democratic Socialism and Caste Issue. Then of course Gail Ombit picked up quite a lot. And after 1974-75, I began to write on that. That's the reason why even today, across state and minority doesn't get as important attention as it should. And I think you as an activist, I would consider that your prime manual, if at all you want to draw something from the Ambedkars, that should be state and minority. For the analysis purposes, for the purposes of understanding the issues, logistic and justification, we have to read Annihilation of Caste, we have to read Buddha and his Dhamma, and we have to read many of his other writing. But I think core, in terms of program, is in state and minorities. Well, these are the preliminary observations that I would like to make. What I am going to do is the following. The reason why I brought Karnataka and why I am going to give you a story, where do the Dalits stand? And by Dalit, I do not mean the former untouchable alone. I mean OBC, I mean everybody. There is to the extent data allows, National Sample Survey and other allows. So it is a story of everybody with a focus on Dalit. Now, why I am bringing this? My presentation with you, discussion with you, will be in two parts. First is the economic and social situation of Dalit in Karnataka. And this credit goes to Jaffet, who got the money from the state of Karnataka. He sponsored a study on the economic and social status, and he asked IIDS to be a partner. So IIDS, Indian Institute of Dalit Studies, and the Center for Social Exclusion and Inclusive Policy has for the first time prepared a report on the status of scheduled caste, OBC and other in a comparative framework, taking all the data into account. And that will present a story. I think he will launch that report. The report is under print now. Draft was sent to the Professor Jaffet. They have approved it, corrections are made. The report will come, and I think it should come in the form of a book. And that will really present the issue. So this is based on that report. You can consider this as a joint presentation by me and Professor Jaffet, because we are sharing this, but I am speaking on his behalf. Now, why are we making this? Why are I am bringing this? And I then being state and minority, the reason is the following. When Ambedkar wrote in 1947, The State and Minorities, he wrote and gave the solution by studying the situation of the Dalit right from 1920 to 1950. In fact, you must know why I'm saying that state and minority is the last word, an important word. The reason is that Dr. Ambedkar started arguing for certain policies for the Dalits from 1919. His first written statement was a statement to the South Bureau Committee, which came in 1919. The constitutional student of constitution knows that we were governed by Government of India Act, and there was a provision there that this act will be act will come for a review after every 10 years. That is why South Bureau Committee came to invite the opinion of the Indians, that do you want to reform this Government of India Act? And if you want to reform, what are your suggestions? They came in 1930. Simon Commission, Ambedkar again appeared before the Simon Commission. Roundtable conference, which finally led to 1935 Act. And 1935 Act constitutes the foundation for our constitution in a way. In fact, Dr. Ambedkar's initial response to Constituent Assembly was that why do you need a Constituent Assembly? 1935 Act is the Indian Constitution. But anyway, the important point is that Dr. Ambedkar began to develop a strategy for Dalit emancipation, why they need a separate solution other than that of a Muslim and Christians and Anglo-Indian and the general. The first statement, written statement is memorandum to the South Bureau Committee. He didn't get anything. He only got one thing, and that is he got the scheduled castes were nominated in the provincial council. That is the only reservation he got. And he was the beneficiary of it. He was nominated in the Bombay Assembly. But beyond that, he didn't get anything. He was a very frustrated man. So he, when the, after 10 years, when the Simon Commission came again to seek the opinion of the Indians on the Government of India Act, he again submitted a memorandum, what is called Memorandum to Simon Commission, and again put the same argument. Then he, when the roundtable conference was called, first roundtable conference, he went there. Congress did not go, he went there. He was condemned. But in second conference, everybody went, including Gandhi. And that led to the 1935 Act and the election, first election based on adult suffrage. And it is there that Ambedkar got reservation, begin with political reservation. And then, of course, when he was a Minister of Labour in the British ministry, he extended the reservation to employment and education. So in fact, reservation in employment, politics and education, as I said in my last lecture, were already acquired by Ambedkar much before we got independence. Constitution only accepted it. So Ambedkar achieved all this. Now, and in fact, I brought all this in my book. You must read that book. Dr. Ambedkar and Social Exclusion and Inclusive Policy. Everything, including state and minority, right from 1990 to 1956, till his last, everything is included in that, and there is a 60-page introduction. So the point that I am making is that the first statement that he had in 1990, till the last statement, that is 1947, state and minorities, and some of the provision in the constitution and later on, these all wisdom of his is culminated into state and minority. That is why state and minority is very important. All improvement that he has made. First statement, South Bureau Committee, second statement, Simon Committee, third statement, round table, then couple of other statements. All they are put together and you can see the final wisdom of Ambedkar in state and minorities. There are some addition here and there after 1947. That's another story. So therefore, state and minority is very important. Now, the point why I'm going back to Karnataka is that nevertheless, when Dr. Ambedkar made a solution, suggested a solution, 60 years have been passed. And the policy that he has proposed, some of them are in operation, particularly reservation in politics, in employment, in education, and it has been extended to all public domain now, housing and everywhere. We have that experience behind us. Then there are general policy which are accepted by various government in the center. There is impact of these. Some of those policies Ambedkar agreed, some of those policies Ambedkar did not agree. Dr. Ambedkar vehemently opposed the land reform and the tenancy reform and consolidation of holding. I'll come to that when I talk about state and minority. And ask for the nationalization of the land. So some of those policies are implemented. Sitting on legislation, consolidation of holding, tenancy reform, land distribution. These are implemented to which Ambedkar did not agree. Now we have an opportunity to see whether Ambedkar was right and wrong in opposing those. Therefore, it is necessary that we take the stock of the last 60 years to the extent data permit us, and then come with the Ambedkar solution and then combine both and see what can we do. And it is more important because, and this is particularly I discussed with my Marxist friend, is that what solution you require, ideal solution you require, everybody may agree. You may agree with Ambedkar, Ambedkar may agree with Marxist and many other ideal solution. But politically, that ideal solution is not possible. So will you wait for 100 years or so till you are able to achieve it, or you are not able to even achieve it? Therefore, what you have to do, that you know the ideal situation, but you can pick up the element of ideal situation and try to bring it into practice in the current situation. Practical aspect of it. That it's not possible to nationalize the land, but can we have a program of national land distribution? Because inequality in land distribution, the key issue, which Marxists will accept, Ambedkar will agree. The solution is nationalization of land. Both of them agree. But it's not practical. It's not possible. So can we have different types of land reform policies to the extent the present government allows? So what you will have to do, third reason why I'm saying that this need to be bring it, that based on our ideal situation, we will have to identify, we will have to develop the strategy which is applicable, which is possible. So that it doesn't achieve the first best, but it achieves the second best. At least you get something. And you bring the changes in the life of the people. While you try to try for your ideal situation. Otherwise, what will happen? That you won't have anything in your hand. You won't be able to make any difference. And you will just remain confined to your thought, your agitation. Beyond that, we won't be able to translate that into some sort of a policy which will bring the change in the life of the people. Well, these are the three reasons why I thought this data is necessary. Okay, let's go to first, I think about 45 minutes or so. Where do the Dalit, OBC, others, and other remaining groups stand? I don't have the data for the others. To the extent a national sample survey data allows us, we should do. I must say that as chairman of the Indian Council of Social Science Research, we have a data on scheduled caste, we have a data on scheduled tribe. We have data on others, high caste. If you take out Muslim and minorities, you can get a higher caste category, and we know their background. But we don't have a data on nomadic, denotified tribe, nomadic tribes. So I had requested Zafed to undertake a study. We gave them the money. That report is there. What is the status of the denotified tribe, nomadic tribe, semi-nomadic tribe in Karnataka? So that also can be brought in. I have not prepared the table for that, but one can certainly study. But now you have a caste census. And caste census, we are scared of bringing it. We brought out some data on scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. But we are shy of bringing the data on all the subcaste. There is a debate going on. I'm going to write on that because I had written in Hindu that caste census is necessary to develop evidence-based policy. But that data is there, and I have brought some statistic from that 2011 for Karnataka. I'll share with you later, beside this data. But we have an opportunity through caste census to get the detailed information of that. We can take that issue for a discussion. What policies we required for the subcaste. There is a whole lot of issue of Mala, Madigas. In each state there is a subcaste issues. In my own state is there. How to deal with that? It's not easy, but we should do that. Now let us go to the actual situation now. Now, what are the goals of our development? The goals of development, generally speaking, are the following. I have mentioned in that we should increase the income of everybody. If there is income in the hand of the people, they can possibly meet their requirement of all kind. That's why our focus is on employment, increasing income. But while doing income, we should have a human development. And human development concept, you know, it includes that not only there should be an increase in the income and the reduction in poverty, but your health should be better, you should have access to education, you should have access to housing, you should have access to other amenities. So that is the concept of human development, which was developed by Amartya Sen and Mohibul Haq from Pakistan, and we have a human development report. But I think, therefore, if you want to reduce poverty, we should have pro-poor development, we should have low poverty, we should have low malnutrition, we should have improvement in the health, we should have access to school and higher education, skill development that we are talking about. We should have access to basic amenities, water, electricity, sanitation and housing. And of course, elimination of caste discrimination and untouchability, gender discrimination. But also, development means that you are able to enjoy civic rights and political rights. You should be a citizen in the sense that you are able to use those citizenship rights, which we do not. And there should be a participation in the governance, in decision making, in policy making. So the sum of it is that we need a human development. The goal of any development policy should be human development, where everybody get enough to eat, everybody has a place to stay, everybody get opportunity to education, good health, employment. There should be non-discrimination. Everybody should be treated equally and equal status, gender and caste and ethnicity and religion. And of course, everybody should have a right to participation in governance. Not that one community or one group govern and we get governed by them. So there should be an inclusive governance. These are some of the goals of development. Please go ahead. Now what I will do is the following, based on the data. And please understand, I will present you the progress that we have made in the human development, or the indicator that I have mentioned before you, between 1993 and 2012. This is the latest data. I can go back to 73, but it's not better. 1993 is a good year because we started liberalization, globalization. You have a concern about that issue also. And then come down to 2012 and then discuss with you the present situation. Why do I write 2010? It should be 2012. So where does the Dalit and OBC and others stand today with respect to some of the indicators of human development in Karnataka? The situation next door to you. And then I will examine what are the causes of low human development and continuing gap between the scheduled caste and the others, and the OBC and others. So we will also go into the reason. We will see the progress, we will see the gap, and we will also see the reason. And then we will also discuss some policy measure, and it is here that I will bring state and minorities. What is Ambedkar's position? In the changing context, what solution of Ambedkar we can implement and what we cannot? Not that those solutions are incorrect, but simply because politically they are not possible, such as nationalization of land. And then, of course, I will urge you, you are already doing everything, so I will urge you people to take the cause. Go to the next page. Well, let me then share with you that the changes that have taken place. First, let us understand one particular point. There is a tendency on some of our writers to say that there is no progress whatsoever. There are those who even argue that poverty has increased. It may be that in some way it might have increased, but I think we have seen some positive changes since 1947 and 1950. What are those positive changes? I am not going to go into those positive changes because we don't have a time. I will come straight away where do we stand. But I will just summarize the changes for you. Is that there has been a decline in poverty. I will give the figure for Karnataka later. With all limitation of poverty data, the poverty has declined in Karnataka as well as in India. Income have increased. Education level have improved. If you look at the literacy rate, it has increased quite a lot from what was in 1950. And now, the literacy rate of women have increased. Healthcare has improved. Civil amenities has increased. Water, drinking water supply has increased. Housing have increased, has improved. Road have improved. And there has been changes in the caste discrimination as well. People have begun to use the 1955 Untouchability Act. Not in all sphere, but in some sphere. We'll come to that, where the discrimination still persists. But where it has changed, there has been an improvement. There is an improvement in employment of Dalit in Karnataka. Practically in every category of A, B, C, D, the proportion of the scheduled caste in Karnataka is in proportion to their population. This is the positive aspect of reservation policy. In the absence of reservation policy in public employment, I don't think untouchable would have got the share. And the middle class and lower middle class that we see among the untouchable would not have come up. And with his backward linkages with the poor, which reduced poverty, that poverty reduction would not have happened. So these are some of the positive changes that we see. But with all those positive changes, the poverty level is still very high, malnutrition level is still very high, access to education is still low, literacy as well as higher education. Problem of houselessness is still there. Access to electricity and drinking water is not adequate enough. Caste discrimination still persists. Gender violence and discrimination still persist with a reduced form. So you have a positive changes, but inequality persists. Human development problems still persist at a lower level compared to the earlier period. That story I'll present to you later, and here I begin. Please go. Now, this is the statistic that we get as far as the population in Karnataka is concerned. This is 2011 census. The scheduled caste constitute about 17% of the population, and the scheduled tribe about 7%. We don't have a separate data on OBC, but I'll give the OBC data later. They constitute about 67%. So scheduled caste and scheduled tribe together are about 25%. Almost one-fourth of the population of the Karnataka, as per the 2011 census, is about 25%. Go to second. These are some of the changes in population and ratio, so you need not spend some time. Please go ahead. This is the population composition by religion. In fact, 84% of the population is Hindu. I don't know why do Hindu feel threatened by little conversion by scheduled caste to Christianity or to Islam. Whatever happens, their predominance and dominance won't get reduced. 84% are Hindus, Muslims are 12%, Christians about 2%. I think Buddhists have a very small proportion, but that figure will have to be checked up. But you can see that Muslims are in the second minority group, but Christians are hardly 2%. This is of course 2001. The percentage must have improved because 2011 data by population, religious population, is yet to come. Please go ahead. Now let us come to the hardcore variable. What is the urbanization? Urbanization and industrialization is supposed to be the source of mobility. This is the state situation. Don't go to rural and urban, but just focus on urban. And you can see that Karnataka is almost 40% of the population is urban, and it's highly urbanized after Maharashtra. Maharashtra is 45%. So I think the second highest. I will have to check up the figure for Maharashtra and Karnataka, but in 2011 population census, 40% of the population is urban area and 61% or 62% in rural area. But you can see the level of urbanization is much lower among the tribal, just 19%. And it is only one-third among the scheduled caste. So scheduled castes are lacking behind compared to others. Others is about 43%. Others are more urbanized compared to the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. So if urbanization is a source of mobility and development, then obviously the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe are lagging behind, and OBC also lags behind. Some of the other figure for OBC which are available will tell you. Some of the bottom OBC, not all OBC. So this is one point that you should note, that Dalits are not able to urbanize and tribals are not able to urbanize as much as the others are able to. Please go ahead. Now let us take some hardcore indicators of development, namely go down. Here is the poverty figure for 2012. This is the latest. And you are aware about the controversy about the definition of poverty line. There are many who disagree with the poverty line. But this is the latest poverty line we have taken, because Zafet's report will be going to government and he got funding, so I do not want it to be on a shaky ground. Tendulkar's poverty definition was the last definition accepted by the Planning Commission. Now there was a C. Rangarajan committee to redefine population, and that report has been submitted to a Planning Commission now. We do not know whether the Planning Commission will continue to publish the definition of poverty line, but this is the latest which is being used by everybody. As for this definition, what you discover is that the total proportion of the poor in Karnataka is about 21% in 2012. Forget about rural urban, 22%. Now this reduced from 50% in 1993 to 22%. So there has been an improvement, rapid decline in poverty. One may raise objection about this, but this is what we have officially. But the other thing that you get is that compared to the all 21%, that is the average productivity, average poverty for the all, the poverty for scheduled tribe is, scheduled caste is 33 and scheduled tribe is 31. So almost two times more scheduled castes are poor compared to tribal. OBC, here comes OBC. Because NSS data give you OBC. OBCs are poor, 18%, and others are 15%. Now you can see the OBCs are much better than SC. In fact, almost double the scheduled caste poverty rate is double than that of OBC. Maybe among the OBC there are most backward and less backward. You might get a variation. But you can see the caste hierarchy. You know, caste system is hierarchical. So the poverty is the highest for scheduled caste, followed by scheduled tribe, lowest for others, and then OBC. Same is the story with the rural urban. I don't want to spend time. Same hierarchy is seen. Again, the scheduled castes are most poor with 37%. But in urban area, tribals are more poor, followed by the scheduled caste. OBC is 15%, others are only 8%. This is the poverty situation in Karnataka. Keep in mind when we discuss solution. Can you go back now? Can you go back? Go back. Now this is some regional feature, because I read a note by Sridharan, Dr. Sridharan, who said that you will be going into some of the regions. So I estimated poverty ratio for the region, which regions are more poverty prone, high poverty than other. You can see, this is not by social group, we can't calculate by social group. But if you take total, the most poor is inland northern region. Could you tell me which are the district? Northern, inland northern, 34% is the highest poverty. Hyderabad, compared to 7% of inland southern, which is most least poor, followed second poverty prone is inland eastern. So you can see that
inland southern is the old Mysore state.
That is why it is better, doing better, much better. So, but you have a huge regional disparities in terms of poverty ratio. You must address this. And I have a feeling that the Dalit and Dalitar and tribal are possibly concentrated in inland northern. I have not seen their population distribution. Okay, so there are regional disparities both at the rural urban. Go ahead, please. Go ahead. Go up. Okay. I should have taken income first and then poverty. But you know, the tables are getting upside down. So let's go to the income first and then poverty. Income, this is the income. This is the only data that you get by social group. Based on NSS data. This is monthly per capita consumption expenditure. But it is just like an income per capita. The income per capita, dar dohi utpanna, what do you say in Karnataka, per capita income? Yeah. So per capita income means per person income, which is very important. If you have income in your hand, you can eat, you can buy, you can send your children to school. So per capita income is the measure. 2012. Now this is the situation. You can see the disparities again. At a state level, for overall, it is 785. Total, 548. Forget about rural urban. 548. But you can very easily see then, it's the lowest for scheduled tribe, followed by scheduled caste, followed by OBC, and followed by higher caste. Caste hierarchy is very, very clear. So, there are inter-caste disparities in income. But one most important thing that you must remember here, that you have a huge disparities between rural and urban. The rural, at a state level, the monthly per capita income is 413 as compared to 785. Almost people in urban area get almost 60% more on per capita basis than in rural area. That's why rural poverty is high. So disparity, rural-urban disparity in income and standard of living is another issue that you will have to address. While you take a pride that Karnataka is most urbanized after Maharashtra, but those who are in urban area are more richer than those who are in poor. So urbanization is not poor. Urbanization is benefiting the relatively rich people more than that of poor. So how can we make urbanization pro-poor is a policy issue which we have to take. Okay, so that is the first. Then go to the poverty we have seen. Go down. This we have seen. After poverty, after income, we see poverty. As I told you, income of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe is lower than that of OBC and others. Therefore, poverty is also higher among scheduled tribe and scheduled caste. Income is total income, but poverty means that income which you require, minimum income that you require to enable you to buy food, buy a house, small house. That income tells you the poor poverty ratio. But these are additional statistics on poverty now. What I have done is I have taken the population share of the caste in Karnataka. Of the total population, the ST account 6%, scheduled caste account about 17%, OBC 53%, here is the population of OBC, and the others 24%. So OBC is the largest group in Karnataka. But what is the share in the population? What is the share in the poor? Is it in proportion to the population? No. You can see that the share of the scheduled tribe in poor, that is more than that of their share in population. Their share in population is 6%, but their share in poor is about 9%. Similarly, the scheduled caste. Their share in the population of the state is about 17%, 16.7, but their share in the poor is 26%. More than double their share in population. They are more poor. Tribal, OBC share is less than their share in population. Their share in population is 53, but their share in poor is only 47, less than. And the high caste, they account about 25% of the population, but they account only 18% of the poor. So who are the most poor then? The most poor are the ST, SC, and even OBC. Because their population is large, therefore their share in poor is also large. So this you will have to take. When we talk of pro-poor policy, when somebody say, why do you focus only on scheduled caste and scheduled tribe and some OBC, the answer is this, because they constitute bulk of the poor, most of the poor in Karnataka. Please go ahead. No. Go down. One by one. Go down. Okay. The second indicators of deprivation after poverty is malnutrition. Because poverty doesn't capture all your deprivations. Malnutrition, National Sample Survey, collect the data, and the malnutrition is defined like this. Underweight children below 3 years. When a baby take a birth, that birth, baby's weight and baby's health is determined by the mother, a mother's health. Therefore, if the children are underweight, it means they are malnourished. The mother is malnourished, child is malnourished, child is born malnourished. So underweight children, this is an official data collected by the International Population Institute, Bombay, and accepted by the government. Now, what is the ratio of underweight children? Forget about rural, urban. What is the ratio? The Karnataka is 28, but invariably again you find scheduled tribe, it's the other way around, I think. The scheduled tribe is 30% and scheduled caste is 32%. One third of the children born belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribe are underweight. It is less for OBC, but it's not that less, 26%, but it is more or less on similar to others. But nevertheless, SC, ST figure is higher. Please go ahead. Go ahead. This is another indicator. Under 5 mortality. Under 5 mortality means what? When the child is born and when the child dies within 5 years, it means the child was born with a low weight and not with enough strength. In fact, this is under 5 mortality. There is a mortality at birth rate and mortality after 1 year is also there. I have not taken it. So, there are 3 concepts of mortality, and you can see that the mortality rate at Karnataka is 60, very high. But within them, it is the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe which are very high, and it is relatively low on OBC and others. So, others and OBC are more or less similar in case of under 5 child mortality and malnutrition indicator as well. But the problem is severe. Your target, as I will come later on, the challenge before you is how do you develop the scheme whereby the under 5 mortality is reduced to 10%, 20%. That no children rise because of malnutrition. Please go ahead. Now this is almost the last table on development. This is the amenities. This is what you required. Beside food, beside health, you required these. Now this is 2011 population census data. Fortunately, I got it for Karnataka in our report, Jaffet. This is a wonderful thing. Nobody can say that you are working with old data. 2011, there is NSS data also, but this is a population census data. What does it give? It gives you how many houses do not have water facilities, drinking water facility, how many houses do not have latrine, how many houses do not have electricity, how many houses household not having drainage connectivity for wastewater. I have not taken the house status as such. We'll talk about that later. What's the statistic? Take the total for Karnataka as a whole. 73% of the household in rural area, please remember, this is for rural, do not have drinking facility as home, which means they go to the tap water, they go well. We have not reduced the drudgeries of the woman. But that proportion is higher for scheduled caste and scheduled tribal. See again. Scheduled caste are performing very badly, even compared to the scheduled tribe on certain indicators. Drinking water facility, having no drinking water facility at home is 84% for scheduled caste, followed by scheduled tribe. It gets reduced for others. We don't have a data for OBC because this is population census data. But same story, you can see that the proportion of the household not having drinking water facilities, not having latrine facility, not having electricity, and not having connectivity for wastage is much higher among the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, of course followed by OBC and others. So scheduled caste continue to lag behind, scheduled tribe continue to lag behind, OBC continue to lag behind compared to the higher caste. NSS data will also give you the OBC figure. We can discuss that later. Please go ahead. Go ahead. This is urban story. Go back. This is urban story. Look at the figure. Household not having drinking water facilities 29% in Karnataka. Of the total household in urban area, 29% do not have tap water in their house. But the proportion is 43 and 47 for scheduled caste. Again, scheduled caste comes on the top, followed by others. And the same story you can prevail. No latrine facility, can you imagine? The difference, the All India, others it is 11%, but scheduled caste and scheduled tribe is about one third. Three times higher, houses do not have latrine facility. Now same is the story about electricity. For others it is 2-3%, it is 8% for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, 3 times more. So this is the situation of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe vis-a-vis others. Let's go ahead. Now, I also wanted to share with you the political representation of the scheduled caste because they have scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. I did not say anything because this is fixed. There is no choice. So you can see that the share of scheduled caste MLAs remained throughout 14%, and it has increased to 15%. The same is the story with the tribal. Please go ahead. This is the story of reservation for the scheduled caste in the state of Maharashtra, Karnataka. Now just focus on the, you have that pointer? No. Just focus on 2012. Okay? Just focus on 2012 for scheduled caste. Now you can see that the share of the scheduled caste, last row, share of the scheduled caste in total government job is about 16.8%, exactly in proportion to the population. Reservation has helped them. So somebody says that reservation has not helped, that's not a correct position. Had there been no reservation, I'm quite sure that this proportion of 16% for scheduled caste would not have been there at all. We have a history of women and Muslims. Muslim population is about 14 to 13, but in the caste, in the assembly, central assembly, parliament, they are just 4 to 5%. Women account half of the population of the country, they account only 10% of the member of the parliament. So why do you require reservation or safeguard against discrimination? The reason is this. So 16%, and you can see in D, 22%. Why 22%? Because Valmikis and scavenging jobs are confined to them. So percentage shoot up to 20% in D. C is 16%, A, B, C 15%. Karnataka is doing much better as far as the reservation is concerned. Because there are states which are not doing better on A and B. A and B proportion in many states is less, but you have much better. It is almost like in proportion to population. Same is the story with tribal. You can see, but tribal story is not, they are much more in D, and they are more or less similar in A, B, C, but I think they are much less than their share in the population. Their population is 7%. At an aggregate level, their share in the total employment is just 4 or 5%. Except the D category, which is equal to population, rest is less than their population share. So problem of scheduled tribe is not fulfilling the reservation. One of the issues that you will have to take is this. Scheduled caste doing is much better, but scheduled tribe is not. Go ahead. Now, let me summarize. What have we learned from this data? We have learned from this data 3 points. One, that there has been a progress in the reduction in the poverty, reduction in malnutrition, increase in the income, access to amenities. I have not given you earlier figure for amenities, but there is, take my word, that there has been an improvement in the access to amenities also, housing, electricity, sanitation. So there has been an improvement. But second important point is that some have benefited more and some have benefited less. The non-scheduled caste, non-scheduled tribe have benefited more. In other words, higher caste benefited more than the OBC. OBC benefited more than the SC. And SC in some cases benefited more than tribal. In some cases, tribal benefited more than SC. This is the balance fact. Very statistically based thing. As far as political reservation and employment reservation is concerned, scheduled caste have benefited immensely. Their share in the employment is in proportion to their population. Tribals lag behind as far as the reservation is concerned. This is the third point. And the fourth point is, and which is more important, that's why we go for this, that despite the progress, since the higher caste and part of the OBC have done better than that of SC and ST, the gap between the higher caste and the SC and ST still persists. The gap between the SC and the OBC still persists. So SC and ST are not able to come on par with the OBCs and the high caste, despite our object, despite our goals and objective. Now let us go to the causes briefly. Why poverty is higher? Poverty and income is the final indicators of everything. There are four or five reasons that are very clear, which I will give you below. Landlessness, that you don't have access to land, agricultural land, which is a source of income. You don't have access to capital in the form of a private ownership, private enterprises. So access to resources which comes through land and capital in the form of private enterprises is much less among the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe. As a result, there is a high dependence on wage labor, high unemployment rate, I'll come to that figure, low access to vocational and professional education, low access to civic amenities, caste discrimination in employment and other markets and civic rights. These are the causes that I can see are responsible as to why poverty in Karnataka is high among scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, followed by OBC. I will give some statistic on this before we go to Ambedkar. Please go ahead. Now, land ownership. Let us come to land ownership. Now, there are two sources of data on land ownership, by caste and aggregate level. One is the NSS. The first figure is the self-employed in agriculture, 2012. I may be making you a little tired, but it's necessary that you understand this fact. No public action can be good provided if you know your problems. So therefore, I'm making you aware about your problem, and then we'll talk about Ambedkar, Dr. Ambedkar. Self-employed in agriculture is 2012. That is the only data, one important set of data on land ownership in rural area. This is rural area. What is your sources of livelihood? Why are you so poor? If you have a land, 7 acres of land, at least you can get an income whereby give you food and you are no more poor. That data is given by National Sample Survey for 2012, and it is called self-employed in agriculture, means self-employed farmer. They don't go as a casual labor. They work on their land and they get their income. So they are called self-employed.
They don't own the land.
They own the land. They own the land, but a very small portion, maybe tenant also. Because they are self-employed, means you can be self-employed on the land which is taken on the rent. But that proportion is small, very small. You can see that at the state level, 42% of them are self-employed farmer. Those who have a land and they are a farmer. This proportion is about 50% for OBC and higher caste. 48%, 48.9 means almost half, is 50%. It dropped down to 18% for scheduled caste. But it is highest for tribal, 52. Because tribals are traditionally land-owning communities. They are in mountains, they are in hilly area, they have a land. It's a different matter. Listen to me carefully. It's a different matter that their poverty is high, despite the fact that they have a land, good or bad quality. They are more poor than scheduled caste, despite the fact that half of them own the land. 53%, more than 53%. The reason I'll come to you later, that we have not paid attention to the productivity and agriculture development of tribals. We have bypassed them completely. Some of the blame goes to the anthropologists that don't touch the culture of tribals. Let them be there in their own area. That's a stupid argument. We should allow them to retain their culture, but we should give them the advantage of scientific agriculture, which we have not done. Land may be inferior quality, land may be not as fertile, but you can develop a technology. You can have flower cultivation, you can have fruit cultivation, you can have tree cultivation, which doesn't require fertile soil. But we have bypassed tribals. We will have to develop a new strategy if we want to talk about tribal. But the pathetic situation is that of a scheduled caste. Because under the caste, they were not allowed to own the land through the customary laws. The proportion of farmer among the scheduled caste is just 14%. That is the first reason as to why poverty among the scheduled caste is high. The poverty of the tribal is not high because they don't have a land, but because the productivity of the land that they own is very low. And that productivity of the land is low because we have not given them the technology. We have given the technology for the farmer belonging to OBC and high caste in a plain land. You had a 5 quintal of rice per acre, now you have 15 quintal. There we have spent money on research and increased their productivity. But we have not taken, we have not undertaken research how productivity of tribal can be increased by giving them the tree cultivation, flower cultivation, whatever can be grown there. Even the grass. If grass can be grown, you can give them the livestock. Isn't it? Cow and buffaloes, if they have a grass field of a larger size. But we have not paid attention at all. Okay, I'll come to that later. Now the second is, second data is 2003. This is a proper landholding survey. This is called National Landholding Survey, NSS Landholding Survey. Here we can get land won and landless. Now land won is proportion is more or less similar on everybody. It says Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribe and other is similar. Land won means even if you have a half acre of land or even a homestead land. The stupid thing is that we include here homestead land, land for houses. Therefore, there is no difference, much difference here. Because everybody has a homestead land. But if you come to landless, then you can see that in Karnataka, the proportion of landless is 14% and it is much higher among the scheduled caste. It is more or less similar among the, for the others. But you get the real story when you go to the proportion of marginal farmer and an average size of land owned. If you take the proportion of marginal farmer, it is much higher among scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. That they have 1 acre, they have half an acre, that's why they are land owner. But look at the average size of land owned. It is 1.37 for others, 0.8 for OBC, it's only 0.4 for scheduled caste. It is higher for scheduled tribe, 0.7. Now, you have a latest figure also on some of these indicators through the caste census, and I would like to share with you. The proportion of the landless household who are drawing major portion of their income from the casual labor, it is about 20%, it is about 22% aggregate level, but it is highest for scheduled caste, 31%. 26% for a tribal and 19% for other. These are the latest by the caste census. Okay, you can see that the moral story of ownership of land is that scheduled castes own much less land compared to tribal, OBC and other. The average size of the land owned by them is very low. The proportion of landless among them is very high. And as a result, this is one of the reasons for their high poverty. The reason for the high poverty of tribal is different, as I share with you. Go to the second table. The second source of income, I am not talking of employment, I am not talking of casual labor, I am talking of resources. So land is one, private entrepreneurs is another, business. Whether you have a factory, you have industry, whether you will have industry or factory, you will have access to determined by the capital. And that capital is reflected in number of enterprises that you own, small and large. Now this is a very standard data. You know economic census, you are familiar with economic census. The advertisement comes from the TV because the 2013 economic census is conducted very recently. And what is economic census? Economic census is nothing but a census of not population, census of the enterprises and the business that you are engaging. So you can identify the household who own enterprise, who have business. Now, that data is 2005. 2013 reports are yet to come. But we have a figure from NSS also. Now, self-employed non-agriculture means those engaged in business and enterprises for 2012. That indicates the access to capital. What is the ratio? In rural area, this is rural area, 11% of the total household in rural area in Karnataka, only 11% of them own some enterprises and business. But this proportion is higher for others, followed by OBC and much less for SC and tribal. So scheduled caste and scheduled tribes are deprived even on ownership of enterprises also, which is one of the major source of income. In urban area, same story. Karnataka being a very highly urbanized state, of the total household urban area, of the total household in urban area, the 41% are the private enterprises and business household. The ratio is highest among OBC, 44% followed by others, 41. So they are more or less same. It is also higher among tribal, but it is the lowest among the scheduled caste. You can see that the scheduled caste lack the resources, both agriculture land as well as capital, private enterprise. This is the impact of denial of property right to them, denial of enterprises to them, denial of any business to them. Tribal, you can see, still they own a much better proportion of household own private enterprises, artisans. But why power? Their poverty is high? Again, productivity. Their private enterprises are small, they produce tribal good, small enterprises, income is low, they can't eat, poverty is high. So the tribal have access to resources, land and capital, business, traditional business. But their productivity, we have not helped them to increase their productivity. For artisan to the modern manufacturer, we have not helped them. So they remain where they are, where the income is low. So you can see that the ownership of capital based on the national sample survey data is lower among the scheduled caste particularly. Now come to the proper survey, private enterprise survey 2005, and we will get 2013 figure very soon. But this gives you very clearly the situation in Karnataka. Please watch it carefully. Of the total enterprises in the Karnataka state, Karnataka is highly urbanized. You are specialized in the information technology sector and all that. Of the total enterprises and business, that is 100. 42% are with the higher caste, 47% are with the OBCs. And it must be, I think, upper OBCs. But scheduled caste, as against their population of 17%, their share in enterprises is only 6. Tribal, as against their share in the population of 7%, their share in the enterprise is only 4. So the ownership of private enterprises by the scheduled caste and the scheduled tribe is much less than their share in the population. Inequality persists. Equality demand that at least their share in the private enterprises should be in proportion to their population, 17% and 7%. But it is much, much less than that. So you can see that is the story. There is another additional figure that I am giving to you, because I will give you some interesting figure later on. That is MSEB, Medium Small Micro Enterprise, is another survey of industries. 60-70% of the enterprises generally is medium, small and micro enterprise. Same is the story. Out of the total enterprises and businesses in Karnataka, the OBC won the highest, 53, almost in proportion to their population, follows by higher caste, but the share of SC and ST is again very insignificant in relation to their population. Please go ahead. What is the moral of the story then? The moral of the story is that the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe own less capital and land. Now, I must make an important point also, that it is not that among the higher caste and OBC there are no household who do not have a land, who do not own enterprises. There is, but the proportion is small. That you must understand. That cut across the caste also. Landlessness cut across caste. But the incidence of landlessness and lack of access to resources in terms of private enterprise is much less among the scheduled caste, followed by scheduled tribe. Now as a result, what happened? If you don't have land, if you don't have a private enterprise, you depend on casual labor for your survival. You have to hire out your services. Here are the figures. This is for 2012, employment, NSS Employment and Unemployment Survey. This is the only survey, authentic survey by the government. Look at the proportion of rural area. In rural area, you get the proportion of farm wage laborer and non-farm wage laborer. And what is the definition of farm and non-farm wage laborer? Those who derive their income, main portion of their income, from casual, manual, unskilled labor, working on the field and the factories of others. Now, if you take rural area, you can very easily see, if you take farm labor, scheduled caste, 57% of the scheduled caste household in rural area are casual labor. That's not followed by tribal. But tribal proportion of casual labor is much less. So the story of scheduled caste is pathetic. This is not that there are no farm wage labor or scheduled tribe and others. But 57% and rest of them are just have some access to asset. OBC 22, but others is 13. And others here also include Muslim, 11%. That is why they are not strictly speaking higher caste. They also include Muslim. Same is the story with the non-farm. Now if you add 56 plus 12, how much it comes to? 8? 68. 68% of the scheduled caste household in rural Karnataka are wage laborer. How will he address their problem? In tribal, about 34-35% are wage labor. Among the OBC, about 25%. And among others, it is just 15%. If you take out Muslim, perhaps the proportion of the higher caste Hindu will be much, much lesser. Now, same is the story in urban area. The proportion of casual labor in urban area is same for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. Close, little more than 30% are casual laborer. And rest are, of course, engaged in private enterprise and regular salaried job. But the proportion of casual labor among OBC and other is much less. So this is the crux of the problem. Why scheduled caste, scheduled tribe are most poor? Because they don't have access to land, they don't have access to resources, they depend on casual labor, where the wages are low, unemployment rate is very high. Roots of poverty you can very easily see, that you know. I am giving you statistic. Hello. Employment rate. Go ahead. I just want to give them. Go ahead. I want to avoid. Go ahead. We come here. I am saving on time. We can take it for discussion. What is the unemployment rate? Those who are casual laborer, those who do not have any means of production, they depend on employment, but whether they get income or not, it will depend on employment. Do they get employment as much as not? Here are the statistics again from the same employment survey. For those youth, boys and girls, 50 plus year. Now you can see, let us take total. Unemployment rate in Karnataka in 2010 is 3.6. Of the total population in Karnataka, in the age group of 15 and above, who need a job, 3.6 are unemployed. But you can see that the scheduled tribe, scheduled caste, and the scheduled tribes are much more unemployed than that of OBC and others. The highest unemployment rate is among the scheduled caste, 5.6. That is also crux, that also gives you the reason as to why poverty among the scheduled caste is high, poverty among the scheduled tribe is high. It is relatively less in OBC. Same is the story in rural and urban area. In rural area, the highest is again for scheduled caste. In fact, others are doing much better. Even tribal is doing much better. But the unemployment rate of scheduled caste youth is 6.3. Huge frustration among the Dalit youth in rural areas. If there is a tendency for you to turn into extremism, the roots are to be found here. If you want to deal the issue of extremism, you have to deal the problem of unemployment of youth. I have written that book has come, Discontentment and Extremism. By Planning Commission, I have an article there. So you can see that in rural area, primarily the scheduled castes are highly unemployment, and reason is, I will go up to that later, it is the discrimination in employment, which tribal do not face discrimination, it is the scheduled caste face. But in urban area, situation is more or less better. Others unemployment rate is high because education level is very high. There are a lot more educated person among the others. I mean, the proportion of educated person is high, it is also associated with high unemployment. Please go ahead. Here is the unemployment rate by age group. This is a conference for the youth. And you are going to educate the youth. These are the unemployment rate for the youth. The total, you can see that the 15 to 24 is the age where the youth want a job after completing higher secondary and college education. What is the unemployment rate? 11%. Then it goes down. But in the age group of youth, which are in the colleges, to whom you are going to discuss, they will going to ask you this question. 11% of them are unemployed. In absolute number, it's a big figure, actual persons. But as you go down the caste hierarchy, Shedulkas unemployment rate is 17%. Tribal is, Shedulkas is 17%. Tribal is much less. Then OBC comes. Then others come. Others because of higher education. But the Scheduled caste is the highest. Other also suffered. But they suffer in a different way. They have a cushion behind. They are not the first generation learners, others. They are second and third. Father is a IS officer. Mother has some job. But these are the first generation youth. 17% of them in the age group of 15 to are unemployed. Please go down. I also give you unemployment because I work little more on this because you wanted to know about the youth. I also estimated the unemployment rate by education level. Which educated class is more unemployed? And you can see here, take the total. Graduate and above and secondary are the highest unemployed, 5% and 4%, compared to illiterate and middle, upper middle. Because illiterate anyhow try to work somehow, maybe for a half a day, maybe on a lower wage. But the higher secondary and graduate who are looking for a job, there the unemployment rate is higher than the state average. But look at the graduate for the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. Graduate among the scheduled caste, almost 12% are unemployed. Highest unemployment rate among Dalit, even compared to the tribal and the OBC and the others. That's why I put in red marks. The story of Dalit is pathetic. And there are no collective action among Dalit. Political party or civil society organization or NGO. We'll take this issue for discussion. But you can see the status of the scheduled caste. And the reason is caste discrimination. Which tribal do not suffer or OBC do not suffer. Please go ahead. Now let me come to the education. No, go ahead please. No. Now your employment, other than casual labor, is determined by your education level, isn't it? So education improve your employability in the market. What is the access to higher education? Here is the primary, secondary, and higher education. And this is for scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, OBC, and others. Forget about secondary and come to higher education. Secondary also is the same story. You can see that the enrollment rate, you know, I began this concept when I was the chairman of UGC. Enrollment rate in higher education is 5% for ST, 7% for SC, 21% for OBC and 22% for other. Look at the access to higher education of Karnataka, of Dalit and tribal in Karnataka. What is the enrollment rate? Enrollment rate is of the total population of the youth. In the age group of 18 to 22, after 18 you go to first degree. 18 to 22, what is that proportion which went to the colleges? This is the story. No comparison with OBC, no comparison with others. Same is the story with higher secondary education. The state average is 69, but it is 59 for ST, 62 for SC. OBC is much better, others are still much better. Access to higher education, I'll come to that later on that issue a little later. So access to them is lower. Come, go back. Karnataka is a state where privatization of higher education is the maximum. Self-financing institution is a leader. I have seen the beginning of privatization. Karnataka is the oldest one. Then came Andhra, Tamil Nadu and state of Maharashtra. Here you get the data, percentage of total student in higher education divided into government, local body and private aided. Private aided are as good as government. And then private unaided. And what is the access for SC, ST, OBC and even total? The privatization in Karnataka is that of the total student population in the state, almost one-third now are going to the self-finance institutions. This is the level of privatization. It was at All India level, it was 7%. Maybe Karnataka was 10% in 1995, but it is now 30%. I think this is the highest for Karnataka. But I think these figures are not correct. I think they have gone up upside down. Can you go back, please? Maybe I have right table. Go back. Just hold on. Here, I think there is some mess up in that table. Let us take a general situation. This is a enrollment ratio by income. Because if it is a self-financing education institution, fees is very high, capitation is very high. So poor cannot afford. So therefore, by income class, this is called quantile. 0 to 20, 20 to 40 rupees, 40 to 60 rupees monthly per capita, 60 to 80, 80 to 100. Now look at this total. Please watch it carefully for your state. What is the enrollment in the higher education institution by monthly per capita? This also includes the government also. You can see that the enrollment rate of those whose income is 80 to 100 and 60 to 80, whose income bracket is very high, is 45% for those 80 to 100 and 19 for 60 to 80. Do you know what is our enrollment rate now for Karnataka? I have told you, no? It is about 25% or I forgot. I think, can you go to that? No, total is here, 17%. Your enrollment rate in higher education is 17%, 20%, better than is close to All India. But look at those who are economically well off, it is 45% and 19%, slightly above that. But go to the poor, 3.6, 9.3, 8.4. Education is being unequally accessed in state of Karnataka. The person with a higher income bracket is having 45% of them go to higher education. If you go to rural urban statistic, it may be 70. You did not go to Europe for a higher enrollment ratio. Europe is here. Because the enrollment ratio of some of the European countries is 45-50. One of the class is having an access which is equal to the best in the Europe also. Now, inequality in access to higher education is a major problem in Karnataka, which you will have to address. Please go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. Just go down, please. Go up. No, go ahead. Go down. Go down. Okay. Now, these are some of the factors which determine your high poverty among the scheduled caste scheduled tribe. One, let me capsulate now. No access to land, less access to land, less access to capital, less access to education, low employability, and as a result, higher unemployment rate, more dependent on casual laborer, poverty. You know the factors now, statistically speaking. Now go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. I don't. Now, I just want to focus on one aspect and then stop my this portion of my presentation. One of the reasons for scheduled caste high poverty vis-a-vis others, even compared to tribal at time, is their caste discrimination. Even the poor coming from different caste are not the same. The high caste poor, high caste worker, high caste laborer do not face discrimination. Neither tribal face discrimination, it is the scheduled caste face discrimination. So the scheduled caste may be similar to the OBC and tribal and other with respect to fact that they are landless, that they are less educated, that they have less access to capital in the form of private enterprise. So both are same, they have a poverty, but the scheduled caste additionally suffered from caste discrimination. That is, they don't have access to the opportunity in a similar way as the tribals and the OBCs and others have. And that is one of the reasons as to why their poverty is high. Now this discrimination is in employment, private market, farmer face discrimination, Dalit entrepreneurs face discrimination. Please read the book by Ashim Prakash, brought out by Rhodes, Dalit Capital. It has come only 2 months before, and it is the story of the Dalit entrepreneurs, what discrimination they face when they start industries, when they start business, in acquiring input and selling the output. How caste matter in business and enterprises is a classic book. So Dalit face discrimination in enterprises. They face discrimination in sale of produce. They face discrimination in various government schemes, food, nutrition, health, JSY, midday meal, Anganwadi, I have our own study. They face discrimination in civic amenities under the Anti-Untouchability Act, water, temple, road, and they face atrocities. Let me give you some little statistics. Go ahead. This is the figure that you should, as far as employment discrimination is concerned, please understand this. This is a table based on the MSME in Karnataka. What is MSME? Medium, small, micro enterprises. Which private enterprises? Where you get bulk of the employment. I have the figure that I have not seen said. 90% of our employment is private. And of that private, almost 60-70% is medium and small. In Karnataka, you get a very interesting statistic. You get the caste of the entrepreneurs who own the private enterprise. And you get the caste of the employee in that private enterprises. The government did not know that this data exists. I have taken it out and produced this wonderful table. You won't get anywhere else. Now, what is this table? You have SC, ST, OBC and others. This is the caste of the owner of the enterprises. Symbiosis, Infosys. Who owned the Infosys? What is the caste background? But it also gives you the proportion of the employees in the enterprises owned by higher caste, OBC, SC and ST. Very interesting. So if there is enterprises in the Karnataka state owned by the high caste, what is the caste background of the employee in their factories and industries? That is the data. Now please look at this. Take others and OBC. Others might include Muslim, very small proportion. Take OB, others and Muslim, what do you find? As far as the others are concerned, which are primarily higher caste, of their total employee, 100%, 100, 58% are from their own caste, others. 26% for OBC, only 7% from ST, 6.7, and only 8.9 from SC. This is the employment pattern of the private sector, where scheduled caste and scheduled tribe put together, I have a feeling, are only how much? 14%, while their population is about 25%, and they need more jobs. So the high caste enterprises give employment almost 85% to the people of their own caste. Come to OBC. OBC. You have not improved the pointer, Pradeep? You don't have pointer? Okay, doesn't matter. Come to OBC. Of the total employees in the OBC enterprises, own enterprises, 22% are others, higher caste. But their own caste is 65%. Imagine, their share in the enterprises must be much less. But of the total employees in the OBC enterprises, 65% employees are the OBC. What are you talking about? When the private sector talk about there is no caste discrimination, how can you say that? Here it is. OBC of the total employee, 65% are from their own caste. Similarly, others, 58%. But look at the SC and ST. There also, let us take ST. So ST is about 34%, but they give 27% to OBC and 27% to others. So STs are more secular than the higher caste in giving employment, isn't it? And that same is the story with scheduled tribe. 54% are from their own caste, but 24% for OBC and 20% from others. 40% comes from the non-scheduled caste. They are again more secular. Tribals are the most secular in providing employment. Now you can see the disparities and discrimination. This is the macro picture. Please go ahead. Now, I don't want to spend time on this, but I just want to make two, three points because I have taken too much of time on this. We will take a break before I start on Ambedkar. He's a heavy stuff. Yeah, we take a deep break. The discrimination faced by Dalit is pathetic. They face discrimination in employment. I don't want to give you statistic. I don't want to give you study. Pradeep has made a mention. I had published an article in EPW, how discrimination persists in employment, in rural area also. They are allowed to work on farm, but there are categories of work where they don't get job. Inside the house, cultivation of vegetable, cultivation of fruits, milking cow, they don't get job. That's why unemployment is high. But they also study discrimination in the enterprises. If you go to the village, you hardly find a shop, grocery shop by untouchable. Why? It's not that they don't have capital. But once they start the shop, nobody, no high caste will buy. We have conducted a study, I think. Karnataka is one of the sample. Nobody buy from their grocery shop. So who are their buyer? Only Dalit. They are small in number. Less demand, less income, less profit, business closed down. You want to have a buffalo under the IRDP? We have seen that in Haryana. So you have a cow, but nobody will buy milk from you. Our study came with the finding that even Jat even oppose buying the milk from the Valmikis by the cooperative, milk cooperative society. They threaten that we won't sell you the milk if you buy the milk from Valmikis. So you sell the buffaloes, you are into debt. Discrimination in business. Discrimination in land. We have studied the discrimination in farming. What is the discrimination? You want the input, you want fertilizer, you want seed, you want private tubular water. You don't get that. You want bullock from high caste, you don't get bullock as much as you want. You don't get tractor on time. So productivity is low, income is low. You turn into a wage labor. This is not the problem of tribal. This is not the problem of OBC. Understand, please. The main question that Ambedkar raised to the Marxists in annihilation of caste is this. That it's a division of laborer. It's not a division of labor. And that the proletariat are not the same. Proletariat is a group, but there is a heterogeneity. There is high caste proletariat, low caste proletariat. The pains and agonies and the problem of Dalits are similar to that of a high caste proletariat, but also different. And how will you handle that? That is the paradox that still continues. That Ambedkar raised that question in 1936. Then, go to the other slide. So discrimination in all market. Land they can't buy. There are difficulties in land. The Gowdas and other would, you have to study. There are indications that the caste, OBC sell land to their own caste only. In a rare case, they sell to scheduled caste. And if they sell the land to the scheduled caste, they charge higher price. So land market remain confined to your own caste. You may have a money because your son is employed in a urban area under reservation. He sent you the money and asked, Papa, buy a land. But you have difficulty in buying the land. Because the customary rule is that your high caste should not sell land to the scheduled caste. That customary law was converted into a regular law in Punjab. Punjab Land Alienation Act, where untouchable were not allowed to buy land by law. Only Jat could buy. That was repealed in 1947 by Sir Chotu Lal, when he was a chief minister. As a result, even today in Punjab, the population of the scheduled caste is the highest, 30%. But the population, the proportion of the landless is the highest, 95%. 90% in some cases, because of this land. So landlessness among the scheduled caste is not because of capitalism and feudalism. Remember well. It is because of capitalism, it is because of feudalism. But additionally, it is because of customary restriction put on scheduled caste not to own land. So you have to see the sources of landlessness among the scheduled caste proletariat and non-scheduled caste proletariat. And then your policy will also be changed. Even today, the same thing happens. The scheduled caste poor live in a scheduled caste locality. High caste poor, which has a proletariat, remain in high caste locality. What kind of fraternity will be there between the two? They don't intermarry, they don't sit together, they don't eat together. We'll come to that issue later. Now, same problem is that discrimination is government scheme. We have done a study, it will be coming in the form of a book. Fair price shop, PDS, midday meal, Anganwadi, and JSY. We have brought out the discrimination faced by the Dalit. not by the OBC, not by the tribals. I will only take the midday meal. You should do a study. I don't know whether there is a study, but there are a couple of studies on midday meal scheme. That untouchable woman is not allowed as a cook or a helper in the school.
That's a big problem.
Big problem. Okay, I have not seen. But apart from dignity issue, that you don't treat me on equal footing as a human being and don't allow me to have a cook, there is other consequences on employment, straight away. In Rajasthan, there are 55,000 midday meal schemes. In one scheme, there are two helper, one cook, one helper. 1,20,000 is the employment. In 60% of the midday meal, Dalit are not allowed to get employment simply because you are a low caste. This is not unemployment because of capitalism. This is unemployment because of caste. So unemployment of scheduled caste in Rajasthan, out of the 1,22,000 job, 60,000 jobs are not available to 70,000 jobs are not available to Dalit simply because you are not allowed to cook. Caste became as an obstacle to get an employment. Unemployment is because high unemployment is there because of this. I have given you one example. Same is the case with Anganwadi, we have seen. Dalit children sit separately, they get food late. JSY we have seen, Janani Suraksha Yojana. Dalit women are asked to deliver on the floor. The Asha, which is supposed to go to the Dalit locality, she doesn't go. She doesn't give the injection by touching the Dalit woman. Or they do not wave the children by holding in hand. The mother has to hold. So all kind of discrimination as a result, access is reduced. They don't get timely medicine and this thing, and that's why then you see the under mortality rate, the mortality rate is high. One of the reason is caste discrimination. There, you know, the problem is to identify and to discuss the problem of Dalit is a lot more tricky for academician. Therefore, they shy away and give all kind of flimsy ground. Let me give you an example. Midday meals, JSY we have seen. When Asha do not come to the village, where there is a JSY, Asha worker is required. She is required to come for 6 days, we have studied. If she doesn't come to the village, everybody suffers. Scheduled caste or non-scheduled caste. That's a general impact of the Asha not being there. But if she comes, the high caste get a service and low caste do not get a service. So there are dual problems. One, if you want to have a solution, what would solution will you do? You will say that, look, to run the JSY properly, Asha should come to the village first. General problem. We have to deal that problem. But after having come to the office, there is a second problem. That high caste get service, high caste woman get service, low caste do not. So you have to have a supplementary policy for having an access to the scheduled caste woman. That is reservation. That is preferential policy. To that we opposed. Why do we oppose? We don't understand. So there are many academic writer. No, general solution will take care of the problem. What will happen to the problem of caste discrimination specific to them? You require dual policy, both for generality of the poor and the poor belonging to scheduled caste. Please go ahead. Now, lack of freedom is there. They don't enjoy citizenship, right? Under the Anti-Intangible Atrocity Act, go ahead, please. This is the table for Karnataka. 2001 to 2030, scheduled caste. I focus on scheduled caste, we can also focus on scheduled tribe. Total cases registered in Karnataka, total crime, 26,941. Annual average comes to 2072. Okay? In 2014, 2,566 cases were registered under all the crime. But of that crime, the PCR, Protection of Civil Rights Act, means Untouchability Act, and Protection of Atrocity Act is the last one. Now you can see that during this last 13 years, average number of cases registered under Untouchability Act is 462. And under Atrocity is 15,153. 10-year picture. So on an average, annually, Dalit registered about 1,166 cases, 1,160 cases under Atrocity and 11 cases under Anti-Untouchability Act. The Anti-Untouchability Act cases are small because now people have begun to register all cases under Atrocity Act. Same, this statistic is for scheduled tribe. Okay. Now the practice of untouchability and atrocity is always is there then. You must understand that the cases registered by Dalit under PCR and POA are severe cases. When the cases became severe and people like you, NGO, go and help, then they register. But on day-to-day basis, there is a huge discrimination which they just accept. So this gives an interest. This is a tip of the iceberg. You know iceberg? Iceberg is the rock of ice. When it floats in the ocean, only 1/10 of is visible. 9/10 is down below. So this is an 1/10 only. The day-to-day atrocities are many. Please go ahead. This is your judiciary and police, institution of social justice in Karnataka. Of the total cases registered under the crime against SC and ST, the pendency for scheduled caste is 79 and scheduled tribe is 80 in the court. And what is the conviction rate? 3.7, 2.9. All India conviction rate is 30%. That is the justice delivered by the institution of justice. That is panchayat, police, public prosecutor and judiciary. Out of the 100 cases, only 3 cases are convicted. Please go ahead. Now, I do not want to go to the primary studies where discrimination is really brought out. There are studies in Karnataka. Somebody should put all primary studies written in local language and put and bring out the actual change. I have done that for Maharashtra, but I won't share. Now, I will stop it here. When we go to the policies now, I will begin with Ambedkar. Thank you very much. Sorry, I have taken a time, but I thought it was necessary.